actually. Good morning.
Good morning.
Praise the Lord. Good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Boy, you miss a service, you miss a lot. You always feel like you're missing out. And thank goodness for Facebook and the other ways we can stay involved and see what's going on. And so, a funny story. I apparently I talk out loud all the time when I don't even know I'm talking, which, shocker, right? You know, I'm a talker. And Michael, he goes, did you just say you're going to Google what does the Lord say today? I'm like, no, I'm not going to Google to see what the Lord says today. I'm not going to let Google tell me what the Lord is saying today. The Lord told me something, and I'm Googling what that means. Like, he's like, well, I wonder if that works. I suppose that the Lord can use Google. He can use everything else. So just for giggles, I was going to Google it after church, but anyway. What does the Lord say today? And I bet I'm going to get a verse of the day or a scripture of the day a thousand different ways, but I just thought that was funny. He's like, did you just say you're Googling what does the Lord say? No, the Lord already told me something, but that's funny. Oh, bless him. Bless his heart. So anyway, what the Lord said today. So I did Google what I thought the Lord was telling me this morning, and usually I'm the cute one that I think I'm making a play on words, but actually the Lord got me this morning with his play on words. I'm like, oh, that's what you meant. So let's start in Ephesians chapter 2. I'm going to read verses 4 through 10. And I think this one I'm going to read out of the King James. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he has loved us, even when we were dead in sin, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace ye are saved. And hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us through Jesus Christ. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourself, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God has before ordained that we should walk in them. And in 2 Corinthians, let me get my little notes here. In 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9, we'll read this out of the Amplified. For you are becoming progressively acquainted with and recognizing more strongly and clearly the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, his kindness, his gracious generosity, his undeserved favor, where am I at? His undeserved favor and spiritual blessing, in that through he was, see how my tongue's tied, in that through he was so very rich, yet for our sakes he became so very poor, in order that by his poverty you might become enriched, abundantly supplied. So I wrote that down, abundantly supplied. And then this is where the Lord did a play on words on me. He told me this morning, grace like rain. Grace like rain. Grace just flows down from the heavens, just like the rain comes. And we just simply receive it. It's the gift. We can't make it rain just as much as we can't shut up the heavens, but he can. And he just showers us every day with his grace and his blessings. And in Romans chapter 5, verses 15 through 21, but God's free gift is not at all to be compared to the trespasses. His grace is out of proportion to the fall of man. For if many died through one man falling away, his lapse, his offense, much more profusely did God's grace and the free gift that comes through the undeserved favor of the one man, Jesus Christ, abound and overflow to and for the benefit of many. We can't compare. Nor is the free gift at all to be compared to the effect that one man's sin. For the sentence following the trespass for one man brought condemnation, whereas the free gift following many transgressions brings justification, an act of righteousness. For if because of one man's trespass, one man's lapse, his offense, death reigned, R-E-I-G-N-E-D, through that one, much more surely will those who received God's overflowing grace, I love that, his overflowing grace, his unmerited favor, and the free gift of righteousness, not only is grace a free gift, but righteousness comes with grace. It brings righteousness. Righteousness, the free gift of righteousness, putting them into right standing with himself, we reign as kings in life through the one man, Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the anointed one. Well then, as one man's trespass, one man's false step and falling away led to condemnation for all men, so one man's act of righteousness leads to acquittal and right standing with God for the life of all men. For just as by one man's disobedience, failing to hear, heedlessness, and carelessness, that many were constituted sinners, so by one man's obedience, that many would be constituted righteousness, made acceptable to God, brought into right standing with him. But then the law came in only to expand and increase the trespass, making it more apparent and exciting opposition. But where sin increased and abounded, grace, God's unmerited favor, has surpassed it and increased the more and superabounded.
Yes.
I wrote down superabounded. So that just as sin has reigned, R-E-I-G-N-E-D, in death, so grace, his unearned and undeserved favor, might reign, R-E-I-G-N, also through righteousness, right standing with God, which issues in eternal life through Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the Anointed One, our Lord. So I thought, okay, well, I was thinking reign, R-A-I-N, and the Lord said, no, when you receive the R-A-I-N, you R-E-I-G-N, you reign. We are to be kings in this world. Because I'll tell you, what I heard over and over again is together, 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 together. We are one with him, and we are one with each other.
Yes.
And when we are one with the king, we are kings.
Yeah.
We are kings in this world.
Right.
And for whatever reason, grace flows down, right?
Mm-hmm.
Authority flows down.
Mm-hmm.
We live in a free enterprise. We live in a republic, right? Not a democracy. We live in a republic, for anybody who doesn't know. We live in a republic, and so it's not a kingdom. But in the kingdom, everything flows down from the king. Everything.
Right.
There is nothing higher in authority than the king in a kingdom. We live in a kingdom.
Right.
We are citizens, ambassadors of a kingdom.
Mm-hmm.
And we are one with the king.
Mm-hmm.
Not only does he receive us, he's in us.
Right.
He's in us.
Right.
You know, we talked about Esther a couple weeks ago, and I'm like, not only does he extend the scepter, we have the scepter in our hands to give
yes.
favor and grace to those around us.
Yes.
We are coming begging when he's like, why aren't you seated on the throne?
Right.
He gets confused when we come and we're asking, and he's like, does the king come and ask the queen, or does the queen come and ask? I mean, we are kings. We are
yes.
seated if we will just rest in him.
Yes.
Just like the rain flows from us, flows authority, flows the power of the
yes.
kingdom. And he told me that this is the posture of power. Because when my hands are raised and when I look up, it just flows down.
Mm-hmm.
But when I go like this, I can't see my toes. That's not comfortable.
Mm-hmm.
If my hands are raised, it's not comfortable to look down. And I feel like so many times we are focused down here. We want to humble ourselves,
mm-hmm.
right? But our position of power is here, because this is where we are one with him, because our eyes are on him, our eyes are on the kingdom, our eyes are on all things are possible.
Right.
Not the things, right? The circumstances. That is the trick, the lie of the enemy, to say, no, look over here. This is more important. Look over here. Your God can't do it. For I know you, right? Look at you. Look at me. Look in a mirror. Look at yourself.
Right.
None of that matters. The only thing that matters is when we look at him.
Yes.
We praise him.
Yes.
And blessings flow.
Yes.
He has said that to me over and over. All blessings flow, that benediction. Through whom all blessings flow. When we are positioned in a posture of power,
mm-hmm.
all blessings flow.
Yes.
And it is, that's the battle.
Yes.
That is the battle to
yes.
stay right here.
Right.
To stay here, to stay focused.
Right.
To not look to the right, to not look to the left, but to stay focused. And that is how we reign. That is how we rule. That is how we are kings
yes.
and priests in this nation. So next time you find yourself going to ask when you should be declaring, the Lord is wanting us to grow up and stop running to daddy for this. You are no longer in diapers. We were talking about this. We are not children. We are not little babies to come and be fed and diapered and pampered and come with our empty bottles begging. We are to be feeding the hungry. We are to be sharing grace to the lost and dying world. We are to be the purveyors of grace and life and truth. We are salt and light to this world. And the Lord says, stop asking me and start declaring. Start walking as kings.
Right.
And all blessings flow.
Right.
All blessings flow
right.
as grace rains down through us.
Yes.
In as we are one in Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Yeah.
To kind of go with that, I was thinking this morning and just meditating on the Lord and His goodness. And, you know, that I love Him, but I can only love Him because He first loved me. Mm-hmm. And because of the grace and mercy that He poured out on me, I get to be a part of His kingdom.
Mm-hmm.
And I was thinking about the love, and I thought, well, how do you learn more? You know, how do you reveal more of His love? And Jesus is love. Mm-hmm. Well, how do I learn more about Jesus? He came to restore that intimate relationship that He had before the fall of Adam. So Jesus became, you know, the Word. Jesus is the Word. The Word mm-hmm. became flesh or whatever. So we have to get in His Word, and we have to read and read and read mm-hmm. to learn more about Him. Because when you think about a relationship, you know, the most intimate one that I've ever experienced is with my spouse. So, sorry.
That's okay.
Is with my spouse. And, you know, when you think about that kind of an intimate relationship, you know the things that they like. You know the things that they really don't care for. You know the things that they experienced as a child. When you are so in tune with your spouse, this is what really spoke to me this morning. When you're so in tune, there are even times, like when you say the same things at the same mm-hmm. time, you know what they're thinking. Mm-hmm. Well, He wants that with us and even more.
Yes.
So that even without thinking, we are speaking
yes.
what He wants to say. We're on, you know, that would be my prayer, that when I open His word, that I can not just come here and see a move of God, that I can leave here a little bit more like Him,
mm-hmm.
that I can, every time I get in His Word, learn a little bit more about Him, so our relationship isn't in the third person, or that I'm going to Him for a prayer or a need to be met, but that we're one. And so, you know, I can just be sitting by myself and just carry on a conversation with Him as if I were carrying on a conversation with my spouse. That I don't have to go to them in the third person. And so I guess I'm praising Him for the privilege to be a part of His kingdom, but then I also, you know, pray, God, that please open Your word to me, that I can be so intimate with
right.
You that I am, in fact, speaking what is on Your
right.
mind.
Right.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Amen.
Again, that one thing.
That one thing.
Because, you know, when we pray, a lot of times we're praying about the situation around us, our feelings, if somebody offended us, or some person we're involved in, and I hear myself yet again, and always, that's all about me.
Yeah.
If we focus on the kingdom, and not necessarily all these things around us, and that involve us, and that affect us, those things will be taken care of. That's what it says in Matthew, you know, seek ye first the kingdom. And all this other stuff takes care of itself.
Yep.
Right.
Amen.
So,
amen.
I love the Lord.
Yes.
Amen.
Lord.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Anyone else have anything they're like? Yeah, Peter.
Several things. First of all, my friend that we prayed for last week, they did his biopsy on his liver, found out that he didn't have cancer or a tumor,
thank
just
Lord.
An infection.
Lord.
Praise
so
the Lord.
We're just believing even if he had cancer, that the Lord took that away, obviously.
That's right. That's right.
I need prayer for my job. Joyce Meyer calls them mind-binding demons. It's almost like I have dyslexia. I can read things, and my brain's just not comprehending right now. My job. My boss finally came forward and said that they kind of threw me out there without any training, so I'm thankful for that. I know that this is not what the Lord wants me to be focusing on. He wants me to be focusing on the business that He wants us to start. But I need prayer for this job because I've got to pay bills, obviously. And right now I'm really struggling with it. I have a lot of pain in my body most days. I need prayer for that. I also have an appointment to have a checkup on my diabetes Friday, believing for a good report. I know that the Lord's healed me of diabetes. I just don't know if it's going to manifest itself before Friday or on Friday. So we'll just wait and see. But
Praise the Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Amen.
Yes, Lord.
Pray for Peter. Yeah.
I want to share a scripture. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living.
Yes. Amen.
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 That's good.
Amen. Yes. Yes. Amen. Amen. Anybody else? Yeah, James.
So it came to me down the way out last night, we're going with trains, and I put together this 3 foot sectional track by myself. It was about 3 feet. Never ever done this. It's like the Lord says everything is in his hands.
Mm-hmm.
So we need to open our hands and reach out to everybody we can reach out to.
Mm-hmm.
And Joe has a friend, girlfriend that's named Connie, and she has chronic kidney disease, and I proclaimed this morning that she should be prayed on, that she shouldn't have to do any more suffering. That lady has a psychology degree. She's very intelligent, told me that I didn't have autism like everybody that was diagnosed with anything. And I know that God said that I'm fairly normal, even though people like to treat me like a pansy at work, and they hope that settled itself. I am, you know, I have been there 14 years, and I would ask for grace and this praying over Connie and the loving hands of your church. I love you very dearly. I do have a special celebration in 2 weeks, which I'll tell you about later, but I ask for your prayers and grace over the situation.
Amen.
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 Amen. Yeah.
I don't want to sound redundant or anything, but I really, really feel strongly that we all need to be praying for our nation.
Oh, yeah.
It's I don't even know what to say about it, other than let's all remember to pray and pray hard that, you know, God's in control.
Amen.
And we just need to remember that and pray that, you know, the best thing, what happened in this election. I hear a lot of worried people and a lot of concerned people and a lot of confused people. And we are the mightiest nation in the world, and we were founded on the principles of God, and I would just pray that we would get someone to know that could get us back to that, and that would listen to the people.
Amen.
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 Yes. Yes, Lord. Anyone else have any prayer requests or testimonies this morning? All right, well, let's stand and go to the Lord this morning. Heavenly Father, we just come before you this morning, and we lift up these knees to you, Lord. The healing touch in the bodies.
Thank you, Jesus.
Peter, Lord, for
praise
Jesus,
God.
You've
heard every need, every
yes,
question.
Lord.
We know, Lord, that you know that
thank
all
you,
we
Lord,
ask is
your
best
for your power.
As
ambassadors
of
the kingdom, Lord, we speak to these circumstances. We speak to the mountains. The mountains should be removed, Lord.
For every name, thank
you, Lord.
We know that you and you alone are able and willing
meet with us
to heal and deliver and separate to save our kind of in Jesus' name. For not be thankful
this
for
us.
Bless us, Lord.
We're
grateful.
Testimonies of your grace flows. Super abounding, super abounding, Lord.
You go before us in all things.
We thank you, Lord, that we will see your goodness. We will taste and see. We have tasted and we have seen that you are good, Lord. We speak to those mountains, Lord, and we will watch them with our own eyes be cast into the sea, Lord. As we search your word, Lord, renew our minds, Lord, that we might understand, that we might grasp, that we might comprehend the depth of your love, the depth of your redemption, the power of your resurrection, Lord. That the life that you have called us to, super abundant life, resurrection life, that the power of your kingdom, let the authority of your kingdom, Lord, flow through each of your children. That you have sealed us by your Holy Spirit, Lord, and called us your own. Let your children arise and grow as all creation moans. generation of the sons and daughters of God, Lord. Let the sons and daughters arise fully matured. Continue our journey, Lord, from glory to glory as we press in, as we move forward, as we look ahead, laying aside those things which are behind us that try to drag us down, Lord, that try to distract us, Lord. We press in, we press forward, Lord. We run the race that you've set before each one of us, Lord, one step at a time, Lord. I thank you for the assembling together of your saints this morning. I thank you for this service, Lord, this time together, where we come to worship you, where we come to be together in your midst, where we come to have our minds renewed by the hearing of your word. Jesus, that we might comprehend the depth, the width, the length of all that you have done, Lord, that your great love, that you first loved us, that you've called us and made us your own. Lord, that you have chosen the human body as your temple. The heart of man is their dwelling place, Lord. Let us focus on the one thing that makes a difference, and it's you, Lord. The one thing that changes the end of the story, the one thing that changes everything, that makes all things possible, it's you, Lord. Our Savior, our King, Jesus Christ. We look to you, Lord. We put our hope and our trust in you, Lord. We will stand upon your word. We believe every word that is written, that lives and moves and has its living being in our hearts, Lord. And we believe that when we speak, our words are the rhema word of God, the living, powerful, dunamis power of God, filled with your Holy Spirit, inspired by your Holy Spirit, Lord. Let us live inspired lives, full of hope, full of life, Lord. Full of joy and peace and all the fruits of the Spirit, Lord. It is a season of harvest in the natural world, Lord, and we are expecting a season of harvest in the Spirit as well, Lord. That all of the seeds that have been planted, all of the dreams, all of the hopes, all of the visions, that this is a season where they shall come to pass. We want to see with our eyes, we want to hear with our ears, we want to touch with our hands your goodness. We are expecting grace to have its perfect way. Lord, give us eyes to see the hurting and the hungry. And let us feed them. Let us open their eyes with your words, Lord, your Spirit words. Let us not just walk through this world, but let us rule and reign in this world. Let us change this world. Let us expand your kingdom one life at a time, one heart at a time. Lord, and we pray for our nation today, Lord. We pray for the future of this nation, Lord. We are electing a leader of this nation. And no matter what the choice before us on the ballot, Lord, you are our leader and our king. And we trust in you, Lord. We put our hope and our trust in you to lead and guide the hearts of the people in this nation, to elect a leader that will represent the heart of the people. Let all the hubbub and all of the lies be silenced, and let the truth rise up. Let the people see and hear the truth. Let the truth rise up. And you, Lord, calm the fear. Your perfect love casts out fear. There is nothing to fear, for you are our hope and our salvation. But we need wisdom, Lord. We need your godly wisdom. We need the lies to be silenced and the truth of the matter to arise. We thank you, Lord. We thank you for the rest that comes just by knowing you and trusting you. We thank you. We thank you for this place to come, this house of prayer. the safe place to come and worship you. Bless this body, Lord. Bless the members of Abundant Life. And we ask you to draw in those who are searching for a home, those who are searching for a safe place to come and hear your word and to know you. We pray for all the churches in this region as you knit together a network of believers, Lord. Reveal yourself, Lord. Reveal your purpose and your plan for this city and for this state and for this nation, Lord. And may it be so in Jesus' name. Amen. Brought a cell phone with you today, just a reminder to please silence them or turn them off. And we have an announcement, the Gideons will be here. That is next Sunday.
Right.
All
right. Who support their ministry? Pastor, you have anything to add to that?
Only that it'll those of you that were here before when they've been here, his presentation will be brief and we'll take up an offering to the Gideons. Have our regular service, maybe a little bit abbreviated, but typically it'll just be a regular service, only that you'll have a presentation to give and then we'll take up an offering for them. They do a great work, and I'm sure most of you are familiar with their Bibles in hotels and motels all over the world, but not only that, but they do take Bibles to other countries. They have them printed in other languages, and so they're getting the word of God out to people that otherwise wouldn't have it, so it's a good thing.
Amen. And Friday, October 14th at 7 p.m. Eastern Gate House of Prayer.
This is our pre-election gathering, right? Debbie's already announced it, but we're going to proclaim it. I believe it's going to be a night of God releasing his glory through his people, right?
Mm-hmm.
Everybody's looking for a person or persons or whatever. Well, guess what? You are those persons.
Yes. Yeah.
So he's going to release his glory. We're going to just come and worship him, guide him. He's going to guide us. Just there hasn't been two nights the same since its inception, what, 3.5 years ago? So come expecting, come hungry, and be blessed.
Amen.
All right, well, let's speak the word this morning. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover.
Hallelujah.
Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant. And Abraham's blessings are mine.
Thank you, Lord.
Toby and Ron. Ron, you guys want to come take the offering this morning, please? Toby, we ask the blessing this morning.
Lord, we're thankful to be here today, to be with your people, to give you honor and glory. God, the words we hear today, we know are true. They resonated through history, still proclaiming your goodness, your love, and your mercy. And we still stand in it, for it is faithful and true, God. Mm-hmm. Till the edge of time, God, it will carry out what it was sent here to accomplish,
mm-hmm.
God. It is set in motion, a process we cannot stop. Your word is moving forward. where people don't take notice, it's still there. It carries out. It accomplishes what it was set to accomplish, and we stand and glorify you in it, God. Now, Lord, we just ask that you'll bless this offering today. Bless the gift and the giver. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Suzanne. Awesome word. Hallelujah.
Let's praise the Lord together right now. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we bless you. We thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Oh, we love you, Lord. We love you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Give him a hand tonight. Praise God. Great job. God bless all of you. You may be seated. Praise the Lord. Appreciate you being here this morning. Thank you, Suzanne, for opening. Great job. Thank Mike and the worship team, as always. Appreciate you being sensitive to the Spirit of God. Thank the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. God's good, isn't he? Thank the Lord. Hallelujah. Sunday school kids, you can be dismissed to go downstairs. Praise the Lord. The day we're living in, you have to be careful saying things like that. I'm not real comfortable with blow-ups of any kind, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Well, you know, before we get into the word this morning, there's been a scientific study, actually in conjunction with a medical team, and they've discovered about child growth. It's amazing. Some of you may already know this, but the fastest growth that children have is the first 30 days after you buy them school clothes. Hallelujah. So I just thought I'd let you know that. If yours is a little short today, why, get out there and hit the stores, praise the Lord, and just watch them sprout. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So I appreciate again everybody participating this morning. And what Suzanne was saying, you know, we're to grow up in grace. I heard her refer to that. And that's the focus of what I want to speak to you about this morning. I mentioned a scripture last week. In fact, I referred to it maybe once or twice. I don't remember now exactly how that message went, but it had me thinking, and I spent a little more time in prayer about that and looking through the Word of God. I think I have a little something that the Lord showed me. You know, you can have revelation without experience. You know what I mean? You can have the intellectual understanding of it, the revelation of it, without actually experiencing it. And if you don't believe that's true, you can look all through the scripture, but I mean, an example would be Joseph, Jesus' father in the natural, or actually his stepfather. But when the angel spoke to him after Mary had told him that that she was already with child and that it was from God, Joseph was going to still divorce her. I mean, he was going to put her away, but he was going to do it quietly so there wasn't a big scene and a lot of embarrassment and humiliation and so forth. And then the Lord came to him in a dream, or an angel came and spoke to him in a dream and told him that the child that she was carrying was the Lord. So he had revelation. He had a revelation of the fact that Christ was coming, that God was coming in the flesh in his wife. But he didn't understand how any of that worked. You see what I'm saying? I mean, he didn't understand. Obviously, he understood the biology of it, but there was no biology in the natural to be understood. So there was something else happening. It was happening in the way that it would be revealed through a natural childbirth, but it wasn't initiated that way. So there had to be some other thing going on. So he had revelation. He had a revelation of God in the flesh, or God coming in the flesh, but he didn't really understand it. He didn't have a real comprehension of that or experience of it. So that's where we are a lot of times. And that's not to say that we're ignorant or that we're bad or anything else. It's just that a lot of times we get information and revelation before we can actually know what to do with it. Praise the Lord. If that were not the case, then we would read the Bible immediately. We'd know everything, and we'd just walk in it, and that'd be the end of it, right? So that's what I want to talk to you about this morning. And just to preface before we get to actually to the scriptures, I just want to say that Jesus, the man, said, now he was a man when he said this. He said, I and my Father are one. He said, when you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Well, the Father's invisible. So what they saw was a man.
Exactly.
Okay? Now, Jesus said, all the fullness of the Godhead dwells in me. And he said, you're complete in him. He was the firstborn, the scripture says, of many brethren. The many after him would be us. So with that understanding, I'd like you just, if you can just kind of focus on that, and then as we get into this, I think it'll make more sense, hopefully, to you the way it has to me. So I want to begin in John chapter 14, and I'm going to read the first 10 verses, Mike, John 14, 1 through 10. And this is the scripture that I referred to last week, because we've always read it as a kind of a, you know, Jesus telling people, don't freak out because you're going to die. You're going to heaven. I'm going to fix a place, and God's got this huge mansion up there, and in that mansion are a whole bunch of condos or something, you know. And so I'm going to go fix this place up for you so you can come and stay there. Now, I'm not taking anything away from the fact that we are going to go to heaven. But I'm saying that that's not what this scripture is about, because when you read the rest of the scripture after those first three or four verses, you realize the context that Jesus is speaking in has nothing to do with that. It has something to do altogether with something different. Amen? And you'll see that as we go on. So here he starts out. He says, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I'll come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye be also. And whither I go, ye know, and the way ye know. Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man cometh unto the Father but by me. Now remember, this is the context of this Father's house. He said, nobody's going to the Father except they come through me, right? If ye had known me, you should have known my Father also, and from henceforth you know him and have seen him. And Philip saith unto him, Lord, show us the Father, and it sufficeth us. Jesus saith unto him, have I been so long time with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? He that hath seen me hath seen the Father. How sayest thou then, show us the Father? Believest thou not that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works. So, keep that in mind. That's the context in which Jesus is trying to show us something here, trying to reveal something to us. Amen? So then I want us to go back to Luke chapter 15 and begin at verse 11, Mike, and we'll just read all through this. I'm sure most of you are very familiar with this. It's the story of the prodigal son. But I want to show you what the Lord has kind of dealt with me about. It's Luke 15, beginning at verse 11 and right on through to the end of the chapter, which is 32. So Luke 15, 11 through 32. So he said, a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me, and divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee. I am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him, and had compassion, and ran, and fell on his neck, and kissed him. And the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven, and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe, and put it on him, put a ring on his hand, and shoes on his feet. And bring hither the fatted calf, and kill it, and let us eat, and be merry. For this my son was dead, and is alive again. He was lost, and is found, and they began to be merry. and his elder son was in the field, and as he came and drew nigh to the house, he heard music and dancing. He called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said unto him, Thy brother is come, and thy father hath killed the fatted calf, and because he has received him safe and sound. And he was angry, and would not go in. Therefore came his father out, and entreated him. And he answering said to his father, Lo, these many years do I serve thee, neither transgressed I at any time thy commandment, and yet thou never gavest me a kid, that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this thy son was come, which hath devoured thy living with harlots, thou hast killed for him the fatted calf. And he said unto him, Son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine. It was meet that we should make merry and be glad, for this thy brother was dead and is alive again, was lost and is found. Praise the Lord. So, for a lot of years, I've identified with the elder son and the younger son, or the prodigal son. But the father remained the other, kind of outside of the picture. The one who would receive me, forgive me, offer me a home, and give me peace, joy, and love. The Father was the place to return to, the goal, in other words, the final resting place. Over the years, most recently, I'm realizing that I can never be complete as long as the Father remains an outsider. Now, this may all seem very simplistic and obvious, but I'm just talking about the way I think, and I assume that there's probably somebody else out there that does. So, you know, my best theology, spiritual understanding that I've had didn't completely free me from a Father God who remained somewhat threatening. Everything that I'd learned of the Father's love hadn't completely set me free from an authority over me. Authority over me who had power over me and who would and could use it in according to his will. In some ways, God's love for me was limited, and it was limited because of my fear of his power. It may be that the greatest revelation is to let go of all fear of the Father so that we can become like him. That's what grace is for. That's the reason for the message of grace. We can never arrive without it. So, John, go back, if you will, Mike, to John 14, and I want to read just verses 1 through 3. John 14, 1 through 3. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I'll come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And then he goes on to tell us all about he and the Father are one. When you see him, you see the Father. And yet we still have these kind of fragmented images of God as Father and Jesus the Son, God in the flesh. And Jesus is welcoming the sinners with open arms, and yet we have in the back of our mind that, yeah, that's Jesus, but what about God? I mean, what about the Father? He's pretty uptight, you know. I mean, he's got some pretty rigid rules to be followed and so on and so forth. So it causes a conflict in the way that we think. Because as long as the Father evokes fear, he remains an outsider. And he can't really dwell in me. And I can't really dwell in him. You understand what I'm saying? I'm not talking about some spiritual reality. I'm talking about the awareness that I have of this and my ability to function within that revelation. I'm not saying it's not true and it's not possible. I'm just saying it's not real for me if I can't embrace God and be not fearful of him, then I'm missing out here. And that's what grace is for, to let me come boldly to the throne of grace, come boldly to God with whatever my needs are, without any anticipation of God's correction or judgment, or, you know what I'm saying, putting me in my place or something, you know? So as long as God has this, evokes this kind of fear to me, then I can't ever really be complete. Because Jesus said all the fullness of the Godhead dwelled in him, and we're complete in that,
exactly,
in that reality. Amen? And I remember the scriptures that just kept coming back to me. A house divided can't stand. We are the dwelling place of God. We are the house of God, just as God is the house that we dwell in. But a house that's divided can't function properly. A person that's double-minded is unstable in all their ways. In other words, he says, put on the mind. You have the mind of Christ. Put it on. But if you're double-minded, you have the mind of Christ, you're still operating in the natural mind, you're double-minded, you're not getting what it is God has intended for you. And that's the struggle. And part of the reason we don't put on the mind of Christ is because we're fearful what we might think if I really let God's thoughts flow. You know what I'm saying? What I might think about myself, how I might feel about myself, how I might be intimidated. Amen? So even though we are the younger son and the elder son, we're not supposed to remain sons. We are to become the Father. Praise the Lord. We're not to remain them. We're supposed to become Him. That's the purpose. That's the story. That's what He's trying to tell us. Look, John chapter 17, Mike, verses 21 through 26. John 17, verse 21 through 26. I thought to myself, see, if I were to say, now maybe this isn't freaky to you at all, but when I first started thinking about this, I thought, you know, that could be, if we're saying what I'm trying to get across to you this morning, what we're really saying is the same thing Jesus said. And they accused him of blasphemy. They accused him of being out of his mind to claim that he was one with the Father, that he was the revelation of the Father, and all of that stuff. That's the message that he came with.
Yeah.
And we've avoided it like the plague.
Yeah.
But neither shall they say, lo here or lo there, for behold, the kingdom of God is within you. And he said unto the disciples, the days will come when ye shall desire to see one of the days of the Son of Man, and ye shall not see it. See here, or this isn't the scripture I want, Mike. Is that John 17?
I'm sorry.
John 17, verse 21. That they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. And the glory which thou gavest me I have given them, that they may be one, even as we are one. I in them, thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that thou hast sent me, and hast loved them as thou hast loved me. Father, I will that they also, whom thou hast given me, be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory, which thou hast given me, for thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, the world hath not known thee, but I have known thee. And these have known that thou hast sent me. And I have declared unto them thy name, and will declare it, that the love wherewith thou hast loved me may be in them, and I in them. Now, if we're in him and he's in the Father, we're not in three places at once. We are in the Father.
Yes.
He, I, and the Father are one.
Yes.
There's not something else in heaven when you get there that you're going to see other than Jesus.
Right.
Praise the Lord. So he said, I and my Father are one. You're in me. I'm in him. Your revelation of me is a revelation of him. And that's what the world needs to see. So, I mean, no father or mother ever became a father or mother without first being a son or a daughter.
Exactly.
Am I right? Outside of Adam and Eve. And they still had a father who was God. But every son and every daughter has to consciously choose to step beyond childhood. David said, I put away childish things. So everybody has to, at some point, move beyond childhood and become fathers and mothers for somebody else.
Exactly.
It's easy to identify with the two sons. They're outer and inner rebellion is all it is. One, you see the rebellion. The other one is suppressed. It's hidden. But it's still there. So because of that, I can identify with them because it's understandable. It's human. It's the kind of people we deal with all the time. Humans, right? And for a long time, I saw myself as the younger, the prodigal. It never occurred to me that I might also be the older, the bitter. So neither greed or anger, neither lust or resentment, neither carefree or jealousy are completely absent from any of us. We all have those emotions. We all have those feelings that come to us. But what about the Father? Why pay so much attention to the sons when it's obvious that the Father is at the center of this story? The story is about the Father. It really isn't so much about the sons. Why talk so much about being like the sons when the real question is, are you interested in being like the Father? I mean, of course, it feels good to be able to say, these sons are like me. And it gives me a sense of being understood. It's like, okay, you can relate to that, right? So you can understand me. But how does it feel to say, the Father's like me? Or I'm like the Father? Do I just want forgiveness? Or do I want to forgive? Do I want compassion without being willing to offer it? I don't want to just be welcomed home, but one who welcomes home. I mean, there's a subtle pressure in the society that we live in the culture that we live in, and the church is part of that, and that pressure is to remain a dependent child. Praise the Lord. To always be the needy one, to always be the focus of attention, to be all eyes on me. Poor me. Religion has stressed obedience in a way that makes it hard to claim spiritual fatherhood. Because we fail, we don't feel like there's any way we could be a spiritual father. Because we got needs and we've got our problems and our issues, we don't see how in the world we could ever be identified with the Father. Luke chapter 6, Mike, and verse 36. Luke 6, 36. Be therefore merciful as your Father also is merciful. Now, I know, I can't tell you how many times I've read that or seen it or had somebody quote it to me or whatever, but I'm telling you, that is one of the, from what I'm understanding, that's probably one of the most radical statements in the Bible. Yes. Be ye merciful as your Father also is merciful. Mm-hmm. Jesus says, not just how willing God is to feel for me or to forgive me or to have compassion on me, to forgive my sins, to offer me a new life, but he then invites me to become like him and show the same to others that he shows to me. That's what we're called to make reality. Because whether we are the younger son or the older son, we are the sons of a loving Father.
Yes.
A Father who was willing to come in the flesh and die for us so that we could be like him. Praise the Lord. You know, I'm an heir. Not an airhead. That's a whole other conversation. But I am an heir. H-E-I-R.
Yes.
Right? We have an inheritance.
Yes.
All right, Romans chapter 8, verses 15 through 17. Romans 8, 15 through 17. So we haven't received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you've received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father, or Daddy, Father. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, then heirs, and heirs of God, joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that way that we may also be glorified together. Amen. So as a son, or as an heir, we... What does that mean? It means you are to become a successor.
Yes.
I mean, just the definition, right? I mean, we're not trying to read something into this that is disassociated with reality.
Right.
It's a scripture, but he's giving us this as a context, as a way of understanding. So if I'm an heir, then it means that I am to become a successor. I am to be the successor of whoever I'm receiving my inheritance from, right?
Right.
So I'm to be a successor, to step into my Father's place and offer what he offered.
Right.
Praise the Lord. The return to the Father is ultimately the challenge to become the Father. Oh, so now you're blaspheming. You're going to be God, are you? I'm going to be what he declares me to be.
Right.
And you can define it any way you want to. You can try to sort it out and figure it out. But that's the same challenge Jesus had when he came and started saying, I and my Father are one. He, me, I'm in him. And we talk about all that, but we never want to come right down to the real reality of the point, which is me and my Father are one. All the fullness of the Godhead dwells in me as well.
Yes.
Amen. Yes. I realize this isn't a soft interpretation of the parable, but I believe it's the truth. I believe it is what God is trying to tell us.
Yes.
Look, let's go back there again, Mike, to John chapter 14. Just the first three verses will be fine. John 14, verses 1 through 3. Praise the Lord. I want to be a son, right? I want to be an heir. So let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I'll come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Now, he's not talking, this is not about the second coming of Christ and going to heaven. He's coming back. His Spirit is going to come back and dwell with us, so that wherever he is, we are. And if he's in the Father, we can be there with him.
Yes.
Because he and the Father are one.
Yes.
Yep.
Praise the Lord. Amen. So I want to be the son. I want to be the heir. But being in the Father's house is making the Father's house, or the Father's life, because that's what he's really talking about here, it's making it mine and being transformed into his image.
Yes.
Otherwise, this scripture really doesn't, I mean, it seems flaky to me otherwise. And that can't be. In the parable, Jesus is making it clear, God welcomes sinners home. What is home? We came from there. We came from him, out of God. We're going back to God. Before the foundation of the world, we were in Christ.
Yes.
This whole thing is not about escaping hell. We get that. I mean, that's a good thing. And it isn't about, I'm going to get this and get this and get that. We get stuff. We have an inheritance. It's about being the Father. It's about becoming who our identity is in eternity. What our identity is in Christ. I and my Father are one.
Right.
Praise the Lord. Being transformed into his image is what Jesus is talking about. There's a place for you in God.
Yes.
And I'm preparing it. I'm making it possible. And I got to go there so I can send the Holy Spirit back so that you can have a residence in God. So that God can be in you and you can be in God and you can become like God. You can be like your Father.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. You know, my natural father left when I was an infant. So I never knew him. Of course, I got pictures of him and things like that, but I never actually knew him. But what's weird is, the older you get, the more you begin to look like the father. I have an older brother that's 4.5 years older than me. And I don't remember, it was my mother's funeral, my sister's, my brother's, somebody's funeral. And people that came up to me that hadn't seen me for 30 years or so, or longer maybe, since high school or whatever, were commenting on how much I looked like my brother, which we never looked alike when we were young. I mean, we didn't look anything alike other than we were both males. He had black hair, you know. His face was different. We just looked different. And all of a sudden, after 60 years or so, we start looking more alike. But what's really weird is we look like our father. Took a long time getting there. And I'm not crazy about it, but hey, it is what it is. Praise the Lord. We're being transformed into our Father's image.
Thank you, Lord.
Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. Right? If it weren't so, I would have told you. Praise the Lord. In the beginning of chapter 15 of Luke, it says the scribes and the Pharisees, this is leading up to this parable that we spoke of, the prodigal son. He gives another parable, but it's similar. And at the very beginning, he says the scribes and the Pharisees were there, and they were just going nuts on Jesus because of his closeness to sinners. And that's why Jesus then goes on to tell the stories that he tells, the previous one and then the story of the prodigal son. It's really for the Pharisees that he's telling them this because they're not getting it. And they're saying he's crazy, he's a blasphemer, he claims to be God or God in the flesh, and then he's hanging out with all these sinners, which we know can't be right because they're ungodly and unholy and everything else. And so then from that he goes into the story. So the scribes and Pharisees were questioning whether or not Jesus was legitimate. And they were doing that by criticizing his closeness to sinners. So in the parable, Jesus is making it clear that God welcomes sinners home. And becoming like the Father isn't just another teaching, but it's the very heart of the teaching that Jesus came to give us. We're focusing on Jesus, being like Jesus. Okay, I get it, but the point that Jesus was trying to make all the time is this isn't about me, it's about the Father. What you see me doing is the Father. When you see me, you've seen the Father. But we've somehow missed that step and made it like mini-me. It'll be easier to be like Jesus because God is really deep and complicated and God only knows, you know, all that kind of stuff. But we have the mind of Christ. Now, let me say it like this. Just like a natural father, we had grandchildren, three of the grandchildren, Friday night and a Saturday, or Friday afternoon until Saturday afternoon. And I got to thinking about just like it is with my kids. It's like a natural fatherhood. See, and there's a kind of a scary emptiness in spiritual fatherhood. Now, you may think, well, he's just paranoid and he's weird, but there's a scary side to being a parent because you love without any reciprocal behavior.
Right.
You can't help it. It's your child, right? Other people look and say, I don't know how they even put up with that.
Right.
Why would they put up with it? It's my kid.
Yeah.
What can I do? I love him.
Yeah.
So there's an empty kind of thing about being a parent that I don't mean it's not satisfying and all that, but what I'm saying is no matter what they do, you can't help yourself. You got to love them. You may not like them at all. We've talked about all this. You may not like any of the stuff they're doing, but it's a hollow feeling. It's a scary feeling because you don't have control over it. You can't do anything about it. You love them.
Right.
go to the prisons. They're filled with somebody's kids. And those mamas still love them, and those dads still love them. They may despise the things, the mistakes they've made or the choices that they've made, but they cannot help loving the kid because the kid's theirs. It belongs to them. That's what I'm talking about. It can be heartbreaking, but you still love them. That's the kind of being a parent. That's what a father or a mother is. And so there's a sense of emptiness to it in a way, because they may not, they'll go through stages where they don't show anything except, you know, disdain or disgust, you know, for their parents, for your values, for everything. I mean, who knows? But that same emptiness is also the place of true freedom. Because I don't care how everybody else is judging them, it's still my kid. And I still love them. So I can let go of everything else. I can just love simply because that's my role. It's my kid. It's my grandkid. I'm just going to love them because it's all I can do. It's a place where there's nothing left to lose. How many people get hurt by their children? I mean, they do things that hurt you, right? But if you get to the place where you're just sold out to love them, it's freedom. It's a freedom that we only know in that context. In unrequited love, in love that's just released simply because I can't help myself.
Right.
I love them. They're mine.
Right.
And I'm not going to set up all night worrying about everything that they do and judging on a scale. Will I love them less tomorrow because of that thing, or because they didn't come over when they said they should have come over, or they don't come around, they don't call, they don't do this, they don't do that. Ah, where are they? What do they care about me? No, you can let go of it and just love them.
Yep.
Just love them because that's your role. That's what you do as a parent. And that's what this is talking about. There's a place where there's nothing left to lose, where love has no strings, where there's no reciprocity, where real spiritual strength is found. When you reach out and love the lost and they spit in your face or laugh at you, hey, I love you anyhow. God loves you. Here's the offer. Here's the opportunity. I can just let it go. Just love them and let it go. Because every time we touch that emptiness of non-demanding love, that no matter what you do, I'm still going to love you. No matter how you respond to the love, I'm still going to love you. That's the freedom that I'm talking about. I'm not saying freedom doesn't come with a price. I'm just saying it brings freedom. That's the way God is. That's the image that we were created in, to be able to love even when they don't love back. In fact, when they hate you, you still love them. And that's why he relates all of this to a father's love. It's not about the sons. It's about the father. We're not to identify with the sons. We're supposed to be identifying with the father. I'm in him. You're in me. We're all one. Every time we touch that place of non-demanding love, come on in, shut the door, let the flies in. Every time we do that, heaven and earth tremble. Angels rejoice. It's about the returning sons and daughters. It's joy of spiritual fatherhood. And living this requires the radical discipline of coming home, of resting in the Father, of being one with the Father. Resting in him. Being in him. Being home. In my Father's house are many mansions. I'm preparing a place for you. See, there hadn't been a resurrection. There hadn't been a death, burial, or any of that yet. He said, I'm going to make it possible for you to be where I've been. one with my Father.
Right.
John 14, 1 through 6, Mike. John 14, 1 through 6. And if you can stay in there, I want to skip down then after we've read that to verses 16 through 18. So let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I'll come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. He's talking about the death, burial, the resurrection, the Holy Spirit being poured out. All right? Thomas saith to him, Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? And Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And then he says this, that nobody comes to the Father but by me. Okay, then if you can, Mike, 16, there we go. And I will pray the Father, and he'll give you another, the Comforter. Because this is carrying on the same context, that he may abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but ye know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. Now, unless you get the context that this all came out of him and it's all going back to him, then it just sounds like gibberish, or it sounds like how in the world, which is what Thomas is saying, how are we supposed to get there? It's like there's these geographic locations somehow in space or somewhere that we've got to get to. And Jesus is saying, look, you come to me, you get the Father. This is how simple it is. It isn't a location. It's a reality. It's a spiritual reality that he's talking about. And you can't have it without the Holy Spirit, which is the Spirit of God. It's not a separate spirit. It's not like here's God and then here's the Spirit and here's the Son. They're all one. They manifest and work out the plan of salvation and the plan of God in different ways, but it's one God. The Shema, the Israel. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one.
Yes.
That didn't change with Christianity.
Right.
God is still one.
Right.
I'm not arguing against the Trinity here. Don't misunderstand me. I'm saying the Trinity is simply a revelation of the one God.
Yes.
Right. Come on.
Praise the Lord. And we are complete in him. I will not leave you comfortless. I'll come to you. See, that is the place where both sons in me can gradually become transformed into the image of their Father. Am I making any sense? Praise the Lord. From heir and child to transformed into the image of my Father.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
That's what Jesus was talking about all the time. I and my Father are one.
Right.
He was the firstborn of many brethren. Right. Why in the world would we think that there would be any other reality for us than to become transformed into our Father?
Thank you, Lord.
Yep.
Become like our Father. Become recognizable by others as the Father.
Right.
So that when people see you, they would say what Jesus was trying to get across to them is, oh, that's the work of the Father there.
Mm-hmm.
Amen? That's evidence of God's reality there. That's proof that God is.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
Hallelujah.
Lord.
Romans 8, verse 29 through 39, and this will be the last scripture. We'll wrap it up here. Romans 8, 29 through 39. Now, somehow for me, it isn't like I think Jesus is lesser, but there's just something about parents, children, grandchildren, you know what I mean? It's just hierarchy, if you want to call it that. But Jesus never spoke of that. He thought it not robbery to be equal with God, and yet made himself of no reputation. He became man. So he said, that mind ought to be in you, to see yourself equal with God, but just no reputation. No glory, no honor, no prestige, but that's who you are. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son.
who is the image of the Father,
that
he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called, and whom he called, them he also justified, and whom he justified, them he also glorified. What shall we then say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? If it's God that justifies, who is he that condemneth? It's Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we're killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us and gave himself for us. For I'm persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other thing, creature, shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Hallelujah. In another place he says, I'm going to go away, but if you, I'm going to the Father. He said, so anything you ask in my name, you'll get it. And greater works than these will you do because I go to my Father. It's not how we elevate ourselves by being more religious, but it's by our identification with the Father that makes possible. That's how Jesus was able to do the things that he did. Are you getting what I'm saying? That's why Jesus said, the works that I do, they're not mine. It's the Father. It's my identification with the Father. It's my knowing that I am one with the Father that makes it possible for anything to happen, that all things are possible for them who believe. Praise God. See, I'm quitting with this. The Father's love reflects the Father's character, not the Son's behavior.
Right.
His love reflects him, not the Son. The whole story of the prodigal, it's not about the prodigal. It's not about the elder son. It's about the Father.
Right.
And we're spending all of our religious life identifying with one or the other. Well, I'm the son. I was a little crazy. I did some stupid stuff, but, you know, I'm back with the Lord now. Everything's cool. Or I've been a religious fanatic, and I've just been bitter about anybody that got any kind of blessing. I can remember when we were in the Holiness Church, people saying, man, if I get to heaven and find out women can cut their hair, I'm going to be one ticked-off individual. Amen? Or if I find out that there's mixed bathing in heaven, and I'm not talking about in the bathtub, I'm talking about going to the pool. That was no-no. You don't do it. You don't go to a swimming pool unless it's stag day, you know. Don't ask me why. I'm just saying. But if I get to heaven and find out I could have been laying around on a beach somewhere looking at women in thongs and not go to hell, I'm not going to be happy. I'm just making a joke, okay? But I'm just saying. We think we're being deprived when we're not being deprived of anything. We're making this about the sons, and God's saying, this is about identifying with me.
Right.
You say, well, I'm so fouled up, and my life is such a mess. It's a transformation. And you can't become transformed to an image that you can't see.
Right.
If we're seeing, if all we can see is God's perfection and God's holiness and righteousness, that's why we have to have grace.
Right.
Because Jesus said, by grace are you saved. By grace, you are made the righteousness of God in Christ, and not by yourself.
Right.
You have every reason, biblically speaking, to identify with your Father.
Right.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
You and your Father are one, in spite of your behavior, because it's about his love and not about your behavior. Behavior will take care of itself if we get an identification. If we can focus on who we are in Christ and what Christ has done. And not only that, but there's no way you can carry out the commandment of God in terms of being a light to this world or bringing love to this world or bringing God into this world without recognizing this. This is the message. The message isn't how good we can be in terms of our keeping the rules. The message is, how much can I be like my Father?
Yeah.
Can somebody just say, when you've seen him, you've seen the Father? Would that be a testimony? Hallelujah. And that's what the scripture is telling us. That's what Jesus did. He went about only doing what his Father would do. Compassion, love, forgiveness. I'm telling you, it's freedom in it because it doesn't cost you a dime. It doesn't cost you anything to love somebody. Once you let go of the what you think you're supposed to get in return. See, the Father didn't love based on the kid's behavior. The Father just loved based on his character. So if we're going to identify with God, we got to just love and let the stuff take care of itself.
Yeah.
But if we're loving with an agenda,
yeah.
You're not loving.
Right.
You're doing something else.
Right.
It's the Father's love that sets us free.
Yes.
It's knowing the truth. The truth, he said, I am the way, the truth, and the light. Knowing the truth will set you free. Because you can just love without strings.
Yes.
I know I'm saying something that's a lot easier to say than it is to do. But that's why you have to surrender to Christ. That's why you have to surrender to God. Because they're still us. And us is not what it's about. It's about him. We came from him. We're going back to him. While we're here, we should reflect him. Amen. Can you say praise the Lord? In his house, there's many mansions. We'll be bumping into each other in Jesus all the time.
Yeah.
If you just know where you live.
Yeah.
If you just know where you are.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Because I'll run into my spouse. I'll run into the guy across the street. That's why Paul said, I want to see nothing but Christ and him crucified.
Right.
In other words, he says, when I look at people, that's all I'm going to see is God.
Right.
Try that for a week.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. It'll change your life.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. And it won't cost you anything.
You
except you.
Yeah.
Oh, baby. We don't like letting go of us. Because we are the thing that holds us together.
Yeah.
What we don't realize is we have no control over any of this.
Right.
We're just billiard balls on the table getting racked around. Amen.
Yeah.
Our Father is who we are.
Right.
He's the cue. He's what sets everything in motion.
Yes.
We need to identify with that. We need to identify with who we are in Christ. That's how he sees us. That's how we have to see ourselves if we're going to be able to reflect him to a world that is in desperate,
yes.
desperate need of a revelation of God, of a vision, of a reality of God in this world. Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap if you would. Praise the Lord. Praise God. Amen. Take a good look in the mirror when you get home and say, man, looks a lot like God.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. We're being transformed.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
We may not all be there completely, but we're being transformed.
Right.
And the more we relinquish our agenda to his, the more revelation there is, the more reality of God there is.
Amen.
The more we see it, the more the world sees it. And that's the reason we're still here, folks. That's the only reason we're still here.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. God bless all of you. Have a great week. Hope we'll see you here Wednesday. If not, maybe next Sunday. God bless you. Have a great one. You're dismissed in Jesus' name.